Welcome back to the Political Checklist here on the Rundown blog. I'm political editor David Chalian, joined by senior correspondent Gwen Ifill. Gwen, we got more clarification to the Republican field in the 2012 nomination fight this weekend. Mitch Daniels announces for family reasons, citing the concerns of his family. He's not going to make the run for the Republican nomination. Where does that leave us?
Well, he said actually he was overruled by all the women in his household, which I completely get. It leaves the two schools of thought. One, that the field is set, that someone's going to have to choose now who to support, and that among those people are going to be three governors, who are Huntsman, lagging, but also Pawlenty, and also Mitt Romney. And someone's going to have to decide, and especially the Republican people with money in their pockets who've been sitting on their money and sitting on their support up until now. The other school of thought is that there's still room for somebody, anybody, to get into this. And what the people most folks are watching may not be the ones who are most likely to get the nomination, but they're certainly the ones most likely to shake things up in Iowa and New Hampshire. And that's, of course, Michelle Bachmann, the congressman from Minnesota, and even Sarah Palin. But what's happening is that Pawlenty is planning his path to the nomination through Iowa, Romney is planning his path to the nomination through New Hampshire, and either one of those people or anybody could knock them off. That's what everyone's worried about.
Yeah, I definitely still see some room for Sarah Palin and Michelle Bachmann, somebody to really fire up that Tea Party element of the Republican Party. I'm sure we'll see someone like that fire up those troops, but the notion of bringing Chris Christie or Jeb Bush into this race, have you seen in all your years of covering presidential politics the notion of drafting a candidate in work successfully?
I don't see it work. But we always talk about it. There's always a draft effort. But usually, seldom is the draft effort so focused on people who've said no multiple times. I mean, how many ways can Chris Christie say no? He has said it again this weekend. And Jeb Bush has said no. And the reason they say no is the reason why a lot of the candidates we thought might run have said no. This would be a tough year, not only for the Republican nominee, but also to run against President Obama. It's interesting that when Tim Pawlenty, in his announcement, targets President Obama directly without even talking about the other Republicans. Mm-hmm. And Mitt Romney's been doing the same thing. So that's where they think they can draw the line most clearly.
Of course, as Mario Cuomo will tell us, every nomination is worth having, right?
Well, is this the same Mario Cuomo who was idling on
the very same one on the tarmac.
On the tarmac.
Speaking of Tim Pawlenty, he is out officially getting in, again, putting out one of his fancy Hollywood-style videos this weekend, previewing the announcement. He seems to take this tack that I haven't caught on to before, and I was at a breakfast with Newt Gingrich this morning, who did the same thing, that in the contrast with Obama, he's not a truth teller. He's not telling you how the reality of how difficult the choices are to get us out of this fiscal situation.
I noticed the same thing, and there's something interesting about that. On one hand, they're obviously making some sort of calculation that President Obama, there are enough people who are distrustful of President Obama that they can tap into that. But the risk they're making is the same risk that I remember Paul Tsongas making, which is, you know, I'm going to be the truth teller. No one really likes truth tellers that much. They don't want to be told like Walter Mondale told them, I'm going to raise your taxes. They don't want to be told this is going to be painful. And that's why we get so many nominees who have found some way to hit that sweet spot where they don't really tell you that, even if they know it. So this is an interesting thing. I know but once again, it's an extension of what we're talking about, which is these guys figure the only way they can get the nomination if they can convince a sufficient number of the American people that they can beat President Obama. But that doesn't sustain itself in a primary race. You still have to explain why you're going to beat the other guys.
Exactly. No doubt about that. And what you were just describing about truth-telling is an excellent segue into this notion of this Medicare battle over Paul Ryan's Medicare plan continues to infect everything from presidential politics. We saw it trip up Newt Gingrich, to politics on the Hill. We see Scott Brown from the liberal state of Massachusetts, the Republican senator there, saying he's not going to vote for the Ryan plan, to this special House race up in New York in the
really
Buffalo area. And I'm curious, first of all, your thought on special elections. Can we learn something from a special election, a one-off small election?
The only thing we can learn from special elections is the snapshot idea, where we are at this moment. Where we are at this moment is that there are enough questions raised about Paul Ryan's plan, and enough successful efforts to characterize it so far, successful efforts, that is, to characterize it as something that will take something away from people, mm-hmm. that you've seen a lot of Republicans running away or at least leaning away from it. The interesting thing about this particular House race, of course, Chris Lee, who was the congressman from this district, is the guy who famously disrobed in front of a mirror, took a picture of him, sent it out to Craigslist. Not a really good idea. But this was also Jack Kemp's old district, mm-hmm. upstate New York, and he was the famously moderate Republican who represented that area. It's very Republican district, and the idea that the Republican nominee for this seat is having such a tough time reflects a couple of things. First of all, she's outspending the Democratic nominee by at least $1 million in a $6 million race. But also, there's a third party candidate who spent $1 million himself, who's trying to run and is undercutting, theoretically, the Republican.
He's running on the Tea Party label. And so he's taking some Republican votes away.
Theoretically. But it also has gotten the attention of all the big time money people in Washington and around the country who want to affect this race and want to use it as a sign of something, which gets back to your question. Is it a sign of something, or is it a sign of this one moment that's going to continue to haunt other Republicans? I don't know yet.
But what we do know is, if the Democrat pulls out an upset victory there, you are going to hear Democratic officials from top to bottom cite the Ryan Medicare plan as the reason that they won that race. They will ignore the fact that there was a third-party candidate.
No. And they take whatever works.
And they will tout that. And there was a poll this weekend that showed her up, and we have no idea what will happen in the election. But if, indeed, the Democrats can successfully continue to box in Republicans on this Medicare plan, it is something that the Republicans are going to have to wrestle with all nomination season long, these presidential contenders.
For Democrats, it changes the subject from talking about the president's health care plan,
right,
which they also they're not in the position to want to defend particularly, and they would much rather to see the Republicans on the offensive with something like this.
That's a very good point indeed, and one good to end on. Thank you very much for being here, Gwen Ifill. As always, every Monday, we'll be back with another edition of the Political Checklist. Click us right here on the Rundown blog next week.